Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Good evening. This is the third class out of four, so we are 75%. Well, 50% going to 75%. So before we begin this session, that is going to be on the mystery of the Incarnation, who is Jesus. I don't know if you have any feedback about the reading of Pope Benedict, if you read it, or any question of last class, because last class we did not have time to do any question. We don't have any quiz today, so you can relax. Any highlight on the reading of He Became Man by Pope Benedict, or any question about last class? Yes?
What could have happened if Adam refused to take the belief offered that what could have happened if Adam refused?
Oh, did you come last class?
Yes.
Okay. Because we spoke that. You mean if Eve ate and Adam no?
Yeah.
No? Oh, that's a good question. I don't know. I don't know if even St. Thomas Aquinas asked that question. But we can think about it. Let's think about it. So.
There wouldn't be the rest
of it. I think that. I think it's sin came in, it would have come into the world anyway. No? It's a good question. I think that when the Bible speaks of Adam and Eve, it's not just like Jesus, the new Adam, it's not only referring to Adam, but both Adam and Eve. So I think there is also like a transmission of original sin through Eve, so.
So they're basically considered as one, even from that time.
Yes, I never thought of that question, but I would say yes, I would consider them as. My common sense would be that Adam in the long run would have followed anyway, so. Good. What is their value? Well, I cannot answer that question, but you can read in the Office of Reading, if you Google Office of Reading of Holy Saturday, it's a very beautiful writing about the descent into hell by Jesus on Good Saturday. That's a very profound topic also, the thing of the descent into hell. So basically, what the faith of the Church believes is that the redemption of Christ is a historical event, and it works both to the future and to the past. So this is a very important topic to understand the work of Jesus that has this aspect. Once and for all. All what Jesus did has this aspect of once and for all. His revelation and his redemption has this aspect of once, like he came to history, one time. And then for all, like for us and for those who are going to come after us, but also for those who came before Christ. So, the meaning of the descent into hell is that the redemption of Jesus also goes backwards to all those just people who are awaiting redemption.
So, do we assume then that that's for Adam and Eve?
Well, yes, I don't know. Yes, I cannot say. But in that writing is by an unknown Christian author. It's a very beautiful description of Jesus reaching out as the new Adam to the first Adam. Yes. So.
There really is. There was a
So there is a, so if this is Christ, like his work goes forward to us, but also goes backward to all the just people that came before him. Well, yes, because he came to undo the work of the consequences that came with the original sin. And because he comes to make of the world and of us a new creation through the church. That's why he's the new Adam. I don't know if anyone pay attention to the second reading this Sunday. I was thinking, I hope all the people at least think that Paul is speaking of the new Adam. Did anyone caught your attention the second reading? You can lie to me and say yes. We are thinking of the second Adam. Good, Michael.
The universality or the oneness of that event is easy for me to understand, but the use of the term that Jesus descended to hell implies to me that he was, that Jesus, the man, was separated from God.
Well, no, that's why the it's not a topic I have studied very much, but I know there's a lot of controversy of what is the meaning of hell in that aspect. It's not, it's hell in the aspect of all those who are awaiting for a savior and a redeemer. It's not those who are completely separated and rejected God.
So like a lot of other things, the use of the word hell is a matter of translation rather than a matter of fact.
Yes, it will be not what we always understand by hell, like the place where those who reject God are. So,
okay.
Yes. Any other comment on last class or?
So regarding this last Sunday and the gospel, rather than the second reading and related to Adam, what caught my attention was the approach that the serpent takes that says, "You will know good and evil." Does that imply that before the fall we didn't have the capacity to discern what was good and what was evil?
Oh, no, yes. Because actually, when God said, don't eat that of that tree, you can eat of all the trees, but not that one. That was a knowledge of good and evil already. But by eating the tree of knowledge, it's like that you become the master of what is good and what is evil.
Yeah, but when you are a child, you can trust your father without knowing why you trust him. So that seems to me what that really means.
Yeah, I think they have like a clear knowledge of what was good and evil. I think the meaning of the tree of good and evil is more like that you become the source of your own morality. But that's more like a biblical interpretation, so. Good.
Father, you asked about Pope Benedict's.
Yes.
So I enjoyed the whole homily. I thought it was really good, but I especially like the part in the second page when he talks about that the creation narrative and that Genesis and the way interprets it in the light of Christ, that this is the fundamental criterion of the Christian interpretation of the Bible, and that the Old and New Testaments should be read together. But it's sometimes hard to find the Old Testament reading that goes with the New Testament.
Well, yeah, I don't think every time there's a connection, yes. It's kind of a principle, but I don't think like this word to word.
But the church tries to in daily readings. They try to make them.
Yes, in the on Sundays, the weekday readings, not usually.
Yeah,
sometimes, yes. But actually the weekly readings, the first reading changes and the gospel never changes. So there's no connection most of the time. In the weekday. On a Sunday, yes. Yes. Just as a summary of the last sessions. No, the first session, the first two sessions, we deepen what? What Jesus did. In the first session, and you can. You can summarize this with the notion of mediation. Okay. So what did Jesus did? What did Jesus do? And we said that he is mediator. So the first level of mediation was in the area of revelation. God showed to us in Jesus who he is. And the other one was in the area of redemption. He died for us. And he came to restore creation from within. So this is like a first approach to the person of Jesus. Today we're gonna see who Jesus is. So it's very important to know what he did, but also it's very important to know who he was. So if you remember last week, we spoke of the four reasons for the Incarnation. He came to take away the sins of the world. He's the Lamb of God who forgives our sins, who expiates, who died on the cross once and for all in the one sacrifice of the cross. Then he came to teach us how to be humans. He revealed to us the face of God and he reveals to us the true face of humanity. He came also to show us his goodness. And he came also to sanctify us through his Holy Spirit. So that's what Jesus did. First he comes to reveal, to show who God is. And second he comes to redeem as a new Adam. Always doing follows being. Like doing follows being. That's a philosophical principle. That's as you are, that's how you act. So today we're gonna not focus so much on what Jesus did, he's doing, but his being, who he is, the mystery of the Incarnation. Imagine that you're a soccer player or like soccer fan or basketball fan or whatever. And you go to play, let's say, soccer, no? And you know this special thing, like to Corvallis next week, Lionel Messi or Ronaldo, this famous, the best soccer players, they will be playing with you. And you know about it, like, oh, like Messi, the best player in the world, he's gonna come and play the game and I'm gonna be there. And so because you know, you go and then you begin to play and Lionel Messi is playing with you, or if you like basketball, like, I don't know, like Michael Jordan is. You go and you are you know that he's there, you know, and so you're amazed, like, whoa, he's so good. So you know who he is and then you get to play with him. So you're amazed at how he plays. But think that one other players, either in the playing with Michael Jordan or Lionel Messi, knows nothing about soccer players or basketball players. Like if you put me, I don't know, in a football field and whomever I play with, I don't know who they are, no? So this guy might begin to play with Michael Jordan, and he says at the end of the game, "Hey guys, did you see that guy? He was so good. I never seen something similar." And everyone look at him, "Oh, do you know who he is? He's Michael Jordan. Who is Michael Jordan?" And then he will start to think who Michael Jordan is, and he will go and see videos and learn about his life. So something similar happens with Jesus. When you think of who Jesus is, there's a moment that Jesus came to us, like history. He played with us, the game. Some people really knew who he was. And these are the angels, or God the Father and the Spirit, no? Like, before he entered the game, they knew who he was. And that's why when you read the passages of the Incarnation, the Christmas story, you see all these angels like amazed about, whoa, Michael Jordan is playing here. But for all of us who are in the rest of the team, like humanity, it took us some research, some time to understand who Michael Jordan is. We saw what he did, and then because of what he did, how he played, we started to think who he was. So it took the church 800 years to deepen the identity of who Christ is. The seed and the core of it is already before the writing of the New Testament, because the Gospels are post-resurrection events. So it's not that they were writing the Bible and, this guy is God. No, because he's risen and he's God, and we know the basics of who he is, we wrote the Gospels. So the core and the seed of who he is already at the beginning. But the deepening of that, it took 800 years. I'm not going to read each, but the church defined who Jesus is throughout the seven councils. Everyone knows what is a council? Who can define what is a council?
Special meeting that was called by the Pope to discuss what was either dogmatic or a threat to being the dogmatic belief or teaching of the Catholic Church.
Good. So it's a gathering of bishops that gathers to define like a matter of faith or moral.
But it was not always called by the Pope.
No.
A lot of the first councils were not really called by the Pope.
No, they are a gathering of bishops in union with the Pope. So I listed there the seven first councils: the Council of Nicaea, 325, the First Council of Constantinople. Those are the places where they gathered. 381, the Council of Ephesus, 431, Council of Chalcedon, 451, Second Council of Constantinople, 553, Third Council of Constantinople, 680, and the Second Council of Nicaea in 787. So these first seven councils, they define the identity of Jesus, who Jesus is. It's important to understand how the church forms dogma, or how the church defines the councils. It's not that they said, well, look, in the next 800 years, every 50, 100 years, we should meet once a year and start to plan who Jesus is. No, none of the councils was planned in advance. They were planned, but it's not that they planned like an American planner. They said, okay, in the next 10 years, we are gonna do stage one, stage three. Like, in the first council, we're gonna define the divinity of Jesus. The second council, the humanity. The third council, his will. The fifth council, his intelligence. And hey, in 800 years, we'll have it all ready. Like, no, America was not discovered. So The councils, they were reactions to heresies. So, as the church was teaching something, within the church, some people like were trying to understand who Jesus was, and they would profess something, and in some cases it was not in line with the sound or true doctrine. So the councils, they are reactions to heresies. Look what St. Augustine says in your handout, point number 2. He says, only because of heretics in her midst could the church find a more exact way to express herself in words. And the Orthodox were preserved in their right thinking because of the false thinkers among them. So, in a sense, do you remember the principle we spoke last week? That out of evil, God can bring a greater good? So, in a sense, these mistakes or these propositions that people were saying, they helped the church understand better who Jesus is. For example, then we're going to see, but every Sunday we proclaim and profess what creed? The Nicene Creed. So that creed was defined where? First Council of Nicaea. That creed was a reaction to a heresy called Arianism. Arius was someone who denied the divinity of Christ. So the council, the key word is consubstantial. It's a, the new word that of the new translation. Actually, it's not new. It goes back like to the year 300. So in the past, we used to say one in being.
One in
being with the Father. Now we say consubstantial. So Arius was saying he's semi-divine. Nicaea said, no, he's consubstantial. He's fully divine. We're going to deepen in that at the end. So that's how the dogmas came to live and to reality in the church. There are three principles to understand the mystery of the Incarnation. And I will say it, and then we will deepen in it, so you don't need to. And you might say, that's really easy. I know that from catechism. Well, it took 800 years for the church to understand this. We say three things that are kept together. One thing about heresies and about the Catholic faith. The way of understanding our faith is a way that includes paradox. So Catholic faith, Catholic spirituality, Catholic dogma includes both and. It's not so much an either or, it's most of the times both and. So it holds things that seems in opposition together, in tension, in a healthy tension. So the heresies, they were always, or most of the times, ways of trying to simplify the mystery and stay with one part. Like heresy comes from that word, like staying with one aspect of the faith, one aspect of the dogma. So, for example, the understanding of the sacrifice of the cross and the sacrifice of the Mass is complex. It's two things that are kind, they seem to be in opposition. How can be one sacrifice of the cross, and then Catholics, they repeat again and again the sacrifice of the Mass? How is that possible? So Luther said, no, like, the Mass is not a sacrifice, it's only one sacrifice. But Catholic says yes, this one sacrifice, once and for all, as the letter of Hebrews says. But in the Mass, in a mysterious way, that sacrifice is represented. It's the same sacrifice represented again. Or Arius, he wanted to defend the unity of God. So if Jesus is God also, and how is this possible, like a triune God? There's only one God. So in defense of the unity, he just eliminated the complexity of the Trinity. And we could go on, the paradoxes of our faith. Like, what does it mean that the laity are priests, and that the priest is priest? Well, there are two things that are held together, intention. Intention means in a good way. So the heresies, they try to simplify the faith and make it understandable. They eliminated the complexity and the mystery. So the three principles about who Jesus is are: one, he's fully human, he's fully divine, and three, and this is the most difficult one, he's the unity in his person. Jesus is not schizophrenic. He's unified in his person. It's what the church calls a hypostatic union. To understand this, we're going to go through the prologue of John, highlighting some aspects. So, the first point, the prologue of John is a prologue of the Bible. Like, you read it, we read it on Christmas Day. Every year, December 25th, we read the prologue of John. It summarizes all the teaching of the Gospel of John. So it's kind of a one-minute preview. So it summarizes, it condenses in a nutshell the message of the Gospel of John. The first thing that we need to know, point number one, is what we call the pre-existence of Christ. All of us, we have only one birthday. Like, you have only one birthday. Like, if you think of the date of birth, you have only one. But Jesus has two birthdays. But they are not the same. So the first birthday of Christ, or the one that we know most frequently, is his historical birth. When is his historical birth? Liturgically. December 24th, 25th. Liturgically, because we don't know exactly. We never saw the passport of Jesus. So that's a historical birth. But there's another birth that is not exactly a birth, but the church calls it a birth, and it's what is called the eternal generation, when Jesus was begotten by the Father. So Jesus did not start to begin here. He existed before. This was his historical birth. But before being in Bethlehem, he already was. That's what John says. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So, John, what he begins to say in the prologue, like, in the beginning, even before everything was made, the Word, the second person of the Trinity, was God. So Jesus begins to be Jesus in his history. Christ begins to be Christ in history. But before that, John says that he was the Logos, he was the Word, and he was a son. He was the son. First, he was the Logos, the Word, the Greek word for word, the Greek word for word, if it makes sense, is Logos, L-O-G-O-S. So Jesus was here, he was Logos. This means Jesus was the expression of the mind of the Father. So the Father thinks himself, and when he thinks himself, he begets the Logos, the Word. So he's the mind of God. But also, the Gospel of John says that he's the Son. If you see in your handout, No one has ever seen God, the only Son of God, who is at the Father's side. In the translation that I read, it says the Father's bosom. That's a very tough word for me to say. How do you say it?
Bosom.
Like, basically, John says he was at the Father's side. Like, before he came, he was the only begotten Son, eternally generated, eternally begotten. Not created, begotten. If you say created, you're in the side of errors. So, eternally begotten by the Father. So there was no time where he was not. There was no time where the Logos, the Son, Jesus Christ, was not. In the beginning, he was with God, and in the beginning, he was God. Look, if you fast forward the Gospel of John, chapter 17, the Gospel says this: Now glorify me, Father, this is in your handout, with the glory that I had with you before the world began. So, before the Big Bang, or whatever, the Great Crunch, or whatever we call it, before the world began, even before time began, even before the creation of the universe, Jesus says, I had that glory with you. I revealed your name to those whom you gave me out of the world. I revealed, first action of Christ, that name. I wish that where I am, they also may be with me, that they may see my glory that you gave me. This is very beautiful, and it's connected with redemption. I wish that where I am, they may also may be. And also, Jesus came to earth, to take us where he is. So Jesus came from heaven to earth to lead humanity, history, anew to where he is. That's what he's saying here. And then he says, because you loved me before the foundation of the world. So Jesus says, he's the Logos, he's the Word, he's the Son that has been being loved before the foundation of the world. Before the foundation of the world, God is eternally loving himself. And Jesus is eternally loved by the Father as a son, as the only son. And that's why this is very important to understand who God is. John says God is love, and all that God does, like creation, redemption, all what God does with you is out of love. And Jesus is the love of God, the one who has been eternally loved by the Father, who comes on earth to show that love and to reveal that love. Remember the second reason for the Incarnation. Imagine you, and actually we see it here, like people in the winter, they go to Hawaii or Palm Spring, and they are there like under the sun, like bathing, and then they come back and all happy and relaxed, and you're here like rainy weeks, and then they are all like this, they are tanned, and you see that they have been sunbathing, and they kind of shine, no? Well, Jesus has been eternally in Hawaii, like eternally in Palm Spring, and he comes to us, this rainy humanity, and his face shines with love. So before his historical birth is his eternal birth, where his Logos, he's the Word, and he is the Son. And that's what he comes to share. And this is, let's go to the second point. So the first point is the pre-existence of Christ. The second point is that St. John says that he was in the beginning with God, verse 2. All things came to be through him. And without him, nothing came to be. He was in the world, and the world came to be through him. So two times, John says in the prologue that all was created through the Word, through the Logos, through the Son. This is called creation in Christ. It's a topic, it's very deep. But in the letter of Paul to the Hebrews, Paul says, in the last days he spoke to us through a Son. Again, a Son. Who made heir of all things and through whom he created the universe. Through whom he created the universe. Then Paul in the letter to the Colossians says, for in him were created all things in heaven and on earth, the visible and the invisible. What is the invisible? What are the invisible things that are created? The angels. So even the angels were created through Jesus. All things were created through him and for him. Everything was created through him and for him. This is beautiful. This is a very important point, and now we are going to see why. Like, Christ not only existed before the foundation of the world, but he's also the source, the cause, through whom God creates. We can say that all things, even in nature, somehow, they have like a kind of Christ-like aspect. Christ-like aspect. It's like when you think of an artist, like for example, I thought of Vincent Van Gogh, no? Like when you see this picture and then you see any of his other pictures, you can tell that they have some type of likeness because they were created by the same person. They have the same style, the same characteristic. So all creation has this aspect of being created through Christ, through the Word, through the Logos, through the Son. This is a very beautiful section in the Chronicles of Narnia that is called the founding of Narnia, where the lion begins to create Narnia, and he creates with a song. Those who read the Chronicles of Narnia, the first book, I put just this quote. The lion was pacing, Aslan, no, was pacing to and fro about that empty land and singing his new song. And as he walked and sang, the valley grew green with grass. It spread out from the lion like a pool. She, I think it's Lucy, felt quite certain that all the things were coming out of the lion's head. So, because he's the Logos, he's the mind, he has the wisdom of God. When you listened to his song, you heard the things, like in Genesis, who spoke, let there be light. You heard the things he was making up. When you look around, you saw them. So as he spoke, they came into being. So here you have the lion speaking this new song and creating the universe, like the sun, the moon, the landscapes, like the mountains, like Crater Lake, and us. So everything was created through him and for him, says John. Okay, before we move forward, what do you think could the Father or the Holy Spirit become incarnate instead of the Son?
That's a trick question.
Hey, you're gonna read the handout. I see someone is reading the handout. Okay, who says yes? Let's just reduce it to a Father. Who says that God could also have sent the Father?
I think he could if he wanted to.
Well, the answer is yes. Yes, the Father could have become incarnate. or the Holy Spirit who can become incarnate. Do you remember last week we spoke of convenience? That necessity could be absolute, or it could be convenient, relative. So, most of the time what God does is not absolute necessity, it's fittingness. It was fitting, it was convenient that the Son, the Logos, became one of us. And now we're going to read why. And before that, it's important to understand that whatever God does when it comes to relating to the world, He does it as one God. Sometimes we think, oh, like the Father and the Spirit were watching the game and said, Jesus, why don't you just go down? No, like, it's not like Jesus, oh, I have to go down. No, it's a common decision. So it's kind of a teamwork. So St. Thomas Aquinas, who asked all questions that you could ever ask, except what would have happened if only Eve. Except that one, I think all the other ones. I think it might be there, I have not read it. No? But he says, there are two, he says three, but I just summarize it to two. I put two. Two reasons why it was fitting that the Word became flesh. That the second person became one of us, and not the Father, and not the Spirit. Who wants to read? He's on the other side. And the first reason is connected with Jesus as Word, and the second one is with Jesus as Son. This is a very beautiful thing that we're going to understand through answering to this question. Who, you want to read?
He is the artist that comes repair the artwork related to Jesus as Word. I answer that it was most fitting that the person of the Son should become incarnate, first on the part of the union, for such as are similar are fittingly united. Now the person of the Son, who is the Word of God, has a certain common agreement with all creatures, because the word of the craftsman, i.e. his concept, is an exemplar likeness of whatever is made by him. Hence the word of God, who is his eternal concept, is the exemplar likeness of all creatures. And therefore, as creatures are established in their proper species, though movably, by the participation of this likeness, so by the non-participated and personal union of the Word with the creature, it was fitting that the creature should be restored in order to its eternal and unchangeable perfection. For the craftsman, by the intelligible form of his art, whereby he fashioned his handiwork, restores it when it has fallen into ruin.
Okay, let's stop there. Like, some of you want to think, oh, Father, let me give me a break. Like, I want a cup of coffee. What is going on here? So basically, Thomas says it was most fitting that the person of the Son should become incarnate. First, because, as we were saying, all things were created through him. In him, he's the eternal concept, he's the Logos, the Word. He's the exemplar likeness of all creatures. So the Father looked at the Son, and all things were in him. So all things have a resemblance to him. So it was fitting that if we are called to become like him, that he himself would come, the artist, to restore that original image. Do you remember last class, the image of the dome of St. Patrick and the restoration of the face of Jesus that became dim? So it was fitting that the Word through whom everything was created would come, he himself, to restore that original art. The second reason is connected not so much with creation, but with redemption, with the final destiny of creation. So the goal of redemption is that we become sons and daughters. So Thomas continues. Secondly, the reason of this fitness, that Jesus, the Word, became one of us, may be taken from the end of the union between the human and divine nature, which is the fulfilling of predestination. This is to say, of such as are preordained to the heavenly inheritance, which is bestowed only on sons, according to Romans 8:17. If sons, heirs also. Hence, it was fitting that by him who is the natural son, men should share this likeness of sonship by adoption. As the apostle says in the same chapter, Romans 8:29, for him he foreknew, he also predestinated to be made conformable to the image of his son. So, what Thomas says is, the goal of creation, the goal of each life, is that you become a son and a daughter through grace. That's the goal. That's why God created the world. If you remember last week, the meaning of divinization is that all that Jesus is by nature, he shares to us through grace. So, St. Thomas says in the letter of Paul to the Romans, we are called to become sons. And if sons, we are heir. So there is an inheritance, the inheritance of heaven. So it was fitting that the one who came to make us his brother was the Son, and not the Father, and not the Spirit. And this leads to point number three, and here we make a break after this. John says the same thing in the Gospel. Those who did accept him, he gave the power to become the children of God, to those who believe in his name, who were not born not by natural generation, nor by human choice, nor by a man's decision, but of God. So Christ came to give us his Spirit so we can become what he is. Naturally, we can become by grace. So this is beautiful. All that Jesus is, like beloved Son from all eternity, just by nature, by who he is, he wants to share it with you. It's like he's like a millionaire that says, like, oh, I have millions and millions of dollars, like, and I have no son, I have no daughter. Would you like to be my adopted son? Like, you say, yes, like, I gain the inheritance. So that's what Paul and John are saying. Jesus is the Son, the only begotten Son, and he comes to share his inheritance with us. He makes us, through the Spirit, adopted sons and adopted daughters. So we gain the inheritance. That is his life, his love. So that's the whole goal of the Incarnation. To make of us, through grace, without us becoming God, like always remaining a creature, but become partakers of what God is. Through Jesus. He mediates revelation and he mediates redemption. Okay, now we 10-minute break and come back. So now we go to point number four. Any question about the first three points? I was telling someone that, like, the prologue of John, like, sometimes you read it at Mass, like, on Christmas Day, and people are like, this is the meaning of the universe, like, please pay attention, okay? So, yes.
Like it said, the goal of creation is redemption and incarnation. I thought last week, or the week before, you said that St. Thomas Aquinas said, became sons of God because of the fall. There were two schools of thought.
Yes, yes. So, I'm the God of falling, falling humanity. Of the goal of the history of salvation, the goal of redemption, is that we become sons and daughters in the Son.
Yeah, so, okay, I'm referring to reason two. Goal of creation is to become sons and daughters, you're saying, God, is that...
Well, yeah, maybe it's not a good expression. So the goal... The goal of the history of salvation, the goal of redemption, is that all of us, that humanity becomes like a child of God, like sons and daughters in the Son. So that we become by grace, by the Holy Spirit, what He is by nature. So
it's goal of redemption is to become.
Yes, maybe the goal, that's another expression, yes. The goal of redemption, yes. Yes, because you need to distinguish between you and a tree. It's not the same. So, although St. Paul says that in some way, redemption has a cosmic aspect. Like even for a tree, it does not change directly. It changed because of us, because we treat creation in a better way. But it's not... Jesus wants to make us sons and daughters. It's not the same us than a tree or than a mountain. So it's not well phrased, the expression creation there, yes. Any other question? Yes?
I'm a little confused on reason one. I understand that Jesus was with the Father at the time of the creation and co-created.
Yes.
But the artists always paint God the Father as the creator, and I always thought of that, and Jesus had a different job, but...
I was speaking with Ron about this, like how, like the action of God, actually this is a very profound topic, but the action of God when it comes, is done as a unity, so... I think you need to acknowledge that it's the whole Trinity that creates. But there is an aspect of through the Son, like through the likeness of the Son. And the Son is the mind of the Father, so He reflects the Father. It's not that the Son has an idea and the Father an idea. Like all that the Father thinks is in the Son. So the Son reflects the mind of the Father. No? So. I don't know if I answered your question. Like in the story of Genesis, you see the Trinitarian action, no? That God speaks, the Holy Spirit is hovering, and then the Holy Spirit is breathed into Adam and Eve. So it's the three are involved. The one who speaks, the Word, and the Spirit. So
it's just those artists that led us astray.
The first ones. Yes. Yes.
In the early part of the discussion tonight, you spoke about the birth of Jesus or the two births of Jesus.
Yes.
The birthdays. The birth of Jesus as a human, but you also spoke of you used the word birth of Jesus.
In an analogy. Yes, an analogy.
It's analogous, but in reality. Jesus has always existed.
Yes.
The second person of God has always existed.
Yes.
Third person of God has always existed. So it's not like there was a time in universal history where God the Father
was
in
not
human
Father.
Terms begot God the Son.
No.
They have always existed together.
Yes, exactly.
Some of the way we speak is an attempt to make it more understandable to us.
Yes, actually all that we speak of God is with human words.
Right.
So, yeah, you're like, like someone's, I think it's Congar, who says this, like, when God descends to us and he builds a bridge between heaven and earth, the bricks he uses are from earth. So the images he uses to reveal and show himself are human. Like, read the Gospels. Jesus says, okay, the Father is like, look at the birds of the sky. So he's always using images, like, how is the mercy of God? Well, like, a good shepherd who goes to the 99, who he uses a human brick, a human image, to speak about God. So that's exactly, when we speak of a birthday, it's an image. Yeah, so we cannot understand the historical birthday in the same way that the eternal birthday of Christ. Yeah. Yes?
Sorry for this one.
I have a shield, like, ready.
but we part of our human nature is our soul. And the Catechism talks about Christ having a human soul, apart from his the divinity. So what happens with Christ's soul?
It remains. So we are going to touch on that. Hmm? So maybe we deepen a little in the in the who Jesus is, the three elements, fully human, fully divine, and the unity. We may need to finish this next week, but we're gonna... So the church, when defending in these seven councils, these 800 years of trying to understand who Jesus is, so we need to be humble. Like, in 1 hour, we're trying to understand what the church, it took like 800 years. It speaks of two likeness, or two way of being consubstantial with Jesus. One, he's consubstantial with divinity. The Creed of Nicaea says he's consubstantial with the Father. All that the Father is, the Son is. He's not less divine than the Father. But also, Jesus is consubstantial with us. All that, what it means to be human, Jesus is. So he's 100% divinity, 100% humanity. But he's not two subjects. John says the Word, the Logos, who is also the Son, I mean point number four, became flesh and made his dwelling among us. And we saw his glory. The glory as the Father's only Son, full of grace and of truth. Let me see what you have in your handout. So, let me see. Yeah, so point number four, the Word became flesh. So, John, what he's saying is, so he says he was pre-existing, he was God, he was with God, through him everything came to be. So, through him, he gave us the power to become sons in him. And then he says the climax is, and the Word was made flesh. And that's why when we recite the Creed on Christmas, we kneel to stress this line of the Creed, and that is based on this line of the Gospel of John. The Word became flesh. When John says the Word became flesh, the word flesh means humanity. But it does not mean confusion. It doesn't mean that he was confused. He became one of us without living what he was. So he remained as God, but the Word took, assume is a technical word, he took to himself a human nature. So he took to himself, he assumed a human nature. he started to exist in history with a human nature, with a human dress. This should be understood in the right way, the human dress. So the one who was invisible became visible. The one who was eternal became temporal. So he becomes the divine face of humans and the human face of God. So this faith in Jesus was kind of established with the councils and through a reaction to the heresies. Today I would like to speak of not so much the heresies against the unity, but the heresies against the humanity and the heresies against the divinity. And some of them, not all of them. So the first heresy was against his humanity. First, people denied the humanity of Christ. This is interesting. The early church, the first denial was not so much of the divinity. It was more of his humanity. So the main heresy is called docetism. Doctio in Latin means to seem. So basically what they denied is that the Word really became flesh. So they say, okay, this man, Jesus of Nazareth, who you see walking, who you see suffering, he's divine, but he seems to have a human body. He seems to have a human body. He's a spirit being, and you see a body, but truly that's not a real body. It's not real matter. That's what is called docetism. So his suffering is not true suffering, because his body is not real. If you think, the Gospels, they already react to this. In the Gospel of John, in the chapter 24, verse 36, Jesus appears, and the Gospel says that they thought he was a spirit, but Jesus says, no, it's me. And he says, look at me. A spirit doesn't have bones and flesh as I have. Touch me, touch my side. Like my body is real. And then he says, give me something to eat. So Jesus was not hungry because he was glorified. So this action was revealing something. He was revealing my body now that it's glorified. And before also, it's a real body, it's a human body. If you go and you kind of put a like a nail in his arm, he will suffer. His body was a real body. So every heresy has a kind of opposite orthodox champion. So you have a heresy, but in reaction to that, you have a true Catholic theologian, in a sense. So two people who reacted to the denial of the humanity of docetism were Saint Irenaeus and Justin Martyr. Both of them, they, in his writings, this is the first centuries, like the first centuries of early Christianity. For example, I put there the quote of Irenaeus. Do you have them? There are some who declare that Jesus Christ did not come in flesh, but only a spirit, and exhibited an appearance of flesh. An appearance of flesh. And the other one is Saint Irenaeus, who wrote a book called The Scandal of the Incarnation. So The Scandal of the Incarnation. Why is a scandal? Because one, the incarnation is a scandal, then his death is a scandal, and then the resurrection is a scandal. Because docetism has this aspect of matter is not good. So that God became to the flesh, that God assumed and resurrected flesh, like matter, that's crazy. So the principle of incarnation reveals to us that matter is good for God. That in heaven we will have matter, we will have a body. So that's the first heresy, Docetism, that was connected with Gnosticism. Gnosticism had this aspect of matter is not good. So it's a scandal that God will assume matter. Like matter is not good. But when John says the word was made flesh, it means matter is good, creation is good, your body is good. And that comes to glorify the body. God comes to glorify matter. Saint Irenaeus has this phrase, the flesh is the hinge of salvation. If the body of Jesus, or if Jesus was not fully human, he cannot be true mediator between us and God. So the fact that the body of Christ was a real body and his person assumed a real human nature is very important for Jesus to be our mediator in the area of salvation. This is a first heresy against the humanity, Docetism. Then there are other heresies that deny what Ricardo was saying, aspects of his soul. So some people say, no, his body was not a real human body. But then a more subtle heresy was, well, yes, Jesus was, he had a human body, but he did not have a human mind. The only mind, intelligence that he had was the divine. And then later on, another heresy said, no, Jesus, yes, he's God, but he did not have a human will. He only had a divine will. So the church always defended the complete humanity of Christ. He has a human body, he has a human mind, and he has a human will. In addition to the divine will and the divine mind, the two perfectly synchronized. That's what we hopefully are going to see next week, how the human and the divine are like, this is the human and this is the divine. They dance together perfectly. Now they are completely synchronized. So that was the first area of heresy, denial of his humanity. The second area of heresy is the denial of his divinity. Do you remember what is the root of most of the heresies? We just said this at the beginning.
Simplify.
No? So they seek to defend one aspect of the faith, but because of doing that, they forget another one. They simplify, they kill complexity. So the first heresy that denied the divinity of Christ is called adoptionism. So basically they say, okay, God is one. And if Jesus was God, there are like two gods. So Jesus was a mere human who received a special gift of God. He received the Logos, or he received the Holy Spirit. And we call him God, but he's not truly God. He's adopted by God. He would be like a super prophet, a super saint. And they say, well, look at baptism. Jesus went, the heavens were opened, and that's where he received the special assistance from God, so he can perform miracles. There was a denial of his divinity, and it's called adoptionism. There are different people who developed this heresy. One was Paul of Samosata in the year 260. Another one was Theodoros the Cobbler, and then many others. In early Christianity, this heresy was not so important. It did not grow so much. But we have a lot of modern versions of this. A lot of people who say, well, Jesus was a great prophet, but he was not truly divine. He was a great prophet, that God used him, but he was not the Word made flesh. He's not the Logos, the eternal Son of the Father, the only begotten Son. He's just a mere human that received an anointing of the Holy Spirit. And as we have him as a prophet from God, we can have other prophets. The once and for all is not real. Because our prophets can come to reveal who God is. The second denial of divinity, and this was more dangerous if you want, is what it was called Arianism. It came from a man called Arius. He was a priest in Alexandria around the year 315, more or less, the first centuries. So he said four things that summarize his thought. One, the Son is a creature. So he's not co-eternal with the Father. He was created out of nothing. Two, the Son has a beginning. There's a famous phrase of Arius, there was a time when he was not. He came into existence before the history began. But there was a time when he was not. Three, he has not perfect communion with the Father. He participates more than any other creature in the wisdom of the Father. But the true essence of the Father remains unknown to the Son. So he's called God in an honorific way. And four, the Son is a semi-God. He's kind of a demiurge that God creates to create the world. So it's a little bit more subtle. He's not saying, okay, God is not, Jesus is not God. He's kind of a special creature that is almost like God, through whom he creates the universe. But there was a time where the Son was not. He's not eternally begotten by the Father. The main champion of Orthodoxy, that kind of combated Arius, who was? Anyone knows?
Athanasius.
And he was exiled, I think, 3 or 4 times. Because Arianism was different than Adoptionism. It grew a lot. What Arius was trying to defend was the unity of God, trying to kill the complexity by making Jesus semi-God. Out of the heresy of Arius came the Council of Nicaea in the year 325. We need to give thanks to Arius. Like, every Sunday we profess the Nicene Creed because of his mistakes. We don't know where he is now, but we profess the faith of Nicaea. And I put 2 sections of the Council of Nicaea. Do you have them in your handout?
Yeah.
Who wants to read it? It should sound familiar.
Yeah.
Who wants to read it? Go then.
We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the only begotten, generated from the Father, is from the substance of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one substance with the Father. Through him all things are made.
So the Creed is meant to express this one, that Jesus is consubstantial, is of the same substance of the Father. All that the Father is, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, he is. Begotten, not made. That's the eternal birth of Christ. And then, this is part of the council. It says, those who say there was a time when he was not. Do you have that quote?
Yeah.
And before he was born, he was not. And that he was made from nothing. Or who say that the Son of God may be of a different substance or essence, or may be created or subject to change and alteration. Such persons the Catholic Church anathematizes. So declares us not in communion. So in a positive way, the Church is saying all the opposite to this. If Jesus is not, he doesn't, he's not of the same substance, homoousis with the Father, like revelation falls down and redemption falls down. That's why the Church always defended the humanity and the divinity united in Jesus. Because he can mediate and show who the Father is, and he can die on the cross for us, because we're human, as God, because he's the Word made flesh. What do you want to do? Questions or read the section of the Catechism that kind of summarizes this? Let's read briefly the, and with this we finish. Before we open to questions, the last minutes, this is a very good book. It's a little deeper, but it explains these aspects of the humanity, the divinity, and the unity in one person. It's called Jesus Christ, the Holy One of God, by Ramiro Cantalamessa. Okay, so now we can comment or questions. As you see, I'm following the Catechism, so expanding what is written in the Catechism. Yes, Ron.
I was sort of empathetic towards some of the people that argued about these things, you know, because that would be your tendency. If it's so mysterious, maybe if we explain it this way, it makes more sense to us, technically. And so it's great that they have these knockdown, drag out fights.
Yes.
Got it out on the table. But, the, you know, for you to say that the Pharisees are often a simplification of things, it's, well, you can really understand why there was a tendency to want to do that.
Yeah, and I think that. I mean, there was no definitions of many things, so some people, I think many of the heretics, they were people of good faith, they were trying to understand the mystery. Many of them were bishops, so, and some of them were patrons of, like...
Unfortunately, many of the political leaders were Arians, and that continued long after Nicaea.
Exactly, yes.
And hurt the Church and caused many martyrs.
Exactly, yes. Like people died because of defending Nicaea. Mm-hmm. Because many of the, some of the emperor, like sometimes the emperor would be an Arian.
Well, Constantine was really an Arian, I think. He became an Arian.
Yes.
The downside of making the Church legal in Rome was that there was a lot of Arian influence.
Yes, the spread of Arianism is a very interesting topic. It's connected with Luther. There's a book called The Arians of the Fourth Century by John Newman. I mean, that's a brick. It's a lot of theology and history, but you can there find all the history of the theology and also the historical aspect of evidence. Yes. Yes, please.
I appreciate when you talk about how we have these heresies with us today. It's not just the historical exercise, and I'm very interested when you talk about how they manifest today, because sometimes I think we don't recognize them because they're familiar.
Yes. Well, it's, I think, yeah, nowadays it seems that we live in a more pluralistic world, no? That just yesterday I was reading the Council of Trent. It was another ecumenical council speaking about the danger of like the reform with Calvin and Luther. And it was, it says like these theories, these ideas are dividing the church and they are so against the truth of what we believe. And so sometimes we just get used to many things. But the church always preserves the fullness of faith. So, but yes, many, many, we are not very creative. We just like hit again what was discussed like centuries again. And like in the, so they have a new face, but it's, they have in their root, they have many, many of these aspects. Yeah.
It's very interesting when you read the Nicene Creed. There's like one sentence about God the Father and like 10 about Jesus, because there was really no debate about God the Father. They understood the concept as a monotheistic religion, but the whole Jesus life was very complex and it had to be spelled out in detail.
Yeah. Actually, like next Sunday when you pray the Creed, recite it because it's a prayer. It's all this summarized in just some few sentences. Someone defined the Creed like, the Creed's like a summary of the Bible in one page. So the Creeds are the summary of the Bible in one page. So yes, I think what you say is more profound, because through Jesus, through what he did and who he is, we access the Father. But our main mediator, the hinge of salvation is Jesus Christ, yes. And the church first defined who Jesus was in these, all these councils, but then it moved to the Spirit and also defined the divinity of the Holy Spirit, because some people were denying the divinity of the Holy Spirit. And then, once we knew who Jesus was in the first 800 years, then, like, the basics of this was defined, but the emphasis was more in his redemption. What did it mean that he redeemed? What does it mean, the atonement? What does it mean, redemption? What does it mean, satisfaction? So once we knew who Jesus was, then we move to what he did in redemption. Like through Anselm, not necessarily through councils. So. Yes?
And the creed that we say essentially was in place in 300 after 325.
Yes, and it was restated many times in many of the councils. Yes.
So updated a little bit. It was updated in those other councils?
I think it was just saying, like, we just say again, restate that we believe what it was said in Nicaea. David.
There was another heresy, not directly a Christological heresy, but Sabellianism, where sort of said that God expresses himself in the three persons.
Yes.
So it's sort of like
it's more a Trinitarian heresy.
Yeah.
I didn't put it just for the sake of simplicity. I kill the complexity. But yes, it's called, it was a priest,
yeah.
I think it was from Rome, called Sabellius.
Yeah.
So basically he tried to defend the unity of the Trinity, the unity of God, saying there are not three persons, there's one God that shows himself with different masks. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. It's called modalism, because it's different modes.
That seems to be a very common heresy now, especially sort of the New Agey kind of expression of things.
Yeah, it would be interesting to say what Ruth was saying of what are the roots of New Age. Like this idea of Gnosticism and Docetism, like the flesh is not good, that came back many times, like even like in with Manichaeism and like a negative view of sexuality, negative view of the body. Many times it came back. Yeah. Yes.
in calling Mary the Mother of God, it was also said that more to protect his divinity as the. When we proclaim Mary as Mother of God, we are saying Jesus was truly God and man.
Yes, that's if you see your handout in the Council of Ephesus. In the year 431, says, affirm that Jesus is one person against Nestorianism. Nestorius was the heretic. And it proclaimed that Virgin Mary is the Mother of God. The word in Latin, in Greek, is Theotokos. So basically, your entry is a very profound topic. That's called the communication of idioms. That because the Word became man, the Word became flesh, Mary became the mother in this sense, the historical birth. But that baby is not a different subject, it's the Word of God that took human flesh. So in that sense, we say that Mary is the Mother of God. Not that Mary was before God, that Mary gave birth to the Word, in a sense, in history. So that's why we say he's the Mother of God. That's why we can say Jesus, God, died. Because the Jesus, the person acting, is a divinity, manifesting himself in the flesh, assuming a human nature. So that's why many of his attributes as a human, in the human nature, are applied to God. We say, like, God suffered, God died, because in that historical being, Jesus of Nazareth, it was the eternal Word of the Father acting, visible, manifested in the flesh. This is,
So I'm reading C.S. Lewis, Your Christianity right now, and he does a really great job of explaining God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, and they can be three different and yet all one. And the whole thing, and he also does a really good job of explaining the whole thing about how we always want a beginning, but there's no beginning with God. And we think of our life as linear. We have a beginning and an end. But God is like a whole sheet of paper, has no beginning and end, just this huge, huge.
That's a good analogy. Yes, Lewis.
Whereas we're a line going across it.
Yeah. That's a good how time and history is in eternity, in a sense. I was speaking with someone. Here we are focusing in the mystery of the Incarnation. The other great mystery is the mystery of the Trinity. Those are the two main mysteries. We are now just focusing the mystery of the Incarnation. But whenever you access anything in Catholic theology, you access all the rest. So you cannot, like, so when you access Jesus, through him you access the Father, you access redemption, you access revelation. When you think of angels, so like whatever door you take, it all leads to the mystery of God. It's an organic connection between all the truth of Christianity. And that's why when you deny one thing, everything begins to fall. So if you deny the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist, you deny the meaning of the Mass, you deny the meaning of the priesthood. you deny the meaning of a church. So it's all connected. All the truth are connected. Some are more important than others. Any other question? I have only 2 minutes. Yes?
You said, so Jesus, when he rose with his body that is full and flesh.
Yes.
And he had the wounds on his hands and his side. Why were those wounds preserved? And was the rest of his wounds cleared out? Were those, like, I've always wondered, well, how come he rose and he had that?
I think it all. Well, that's a more profound question. But it's in the. I would suggest that you read the chapter on the resurrection by Pope Benedict in the book Jesus of Nazareth, where he speaks of the continuity and the discontinuity of the resurrection. So the Gospels, they try to show a continuity because they recognize him, and a discontinuity because they don't recognize him. So it's the mystery of the final state of matter, the glorified matter. Like, those were scientists. Like, the risen body of Christ is a unique matter. It's better, like, if you say, I'm going to go to the moon or to Mars and bring, like a piece of that planet, everyone would be like, there was Roman Smith who passed away. They said that he had like parts of the moon.
Yes.
And so the matter of the body of the risen Jesus is unique. It's glorified matter. It's matter like your flesh, completely like trespass or immersed in divinity. It's an amazing thing. And that is going to be us. All that Jesus is, all that Jesus experienced, and all that Jesus became, he did it so he can share it with us. So that's why, because Christ rose from the dead, he opened the gates of heaven. In history, in a partial way, but then in glory. Okay, let's finish.